So thanks for showing up at the booth. Today I show you a module which is called Droid, and it's a universal CV processor. So it has 8 very precise CV inputs, 8 outputs, and with a small text file here, you can configure it to do anything you want. So it can do anything except audio. It can make
T?
LFOs, it can make T, it can make trigger sequences, quantizers, slew limiters, envelope generators, clock dividers, everything you like. So every usual CV task can be done with this module in a very precise way, both in voltage and timing. So it has very, very high quality converters and also very low latency. So we can process pitch information, for example, where it's very important to have precise voltages.
And is this something that exists and is available now?
This is available. This exists. It's already, we have a community on Discord where a couple of hundred guys are around, and we share these Droid patches. And also available are controller modules. You can attach these controllers and map any function you like to the buttons or pots.
Oh, okay. And it's a family of different ones?
This is the P2B8. It means 2 pots, P2 and 8 buttons. And then there's it's quite new. It's also available. It's a P10. It has 10 pots. And then there's a G8 expander, which you can see here. And that gives you 8 more gate outputs. So this combination gives you 24 inputs and outputs total. So you can squeeze really quite a lot of functionality into such a Droid module. And then for the booth, I have something new, which will be available in a couple of months probably. And this is a fader unit. So you have 4 faders, which you can attach. And the special thing is it's motor faders.
Okay.
So let's. Something really new. I think nobody in Eurorack has managed to bring this.
Yeah. Eurorack.
Yeah. The hard thing was to get the power consumption done. This is done by Supercaps. So the voltage imprint on your power supply is quite low.
It so just the caps needs to.
The caps charge up. Yeah. They charge up 30 or 60 seconds, and then you are ready to go. And then you have the advantage that the power these faders draw from your system is quite low. Because a fader can use up to half an amp, just one fader, but only for a short time. So we solved the problem by a very sophisticated power system here. So you can use them without any additional power supplies.
That's very clever. Is there a limit how many times you can move the fader per second then, or are you going to
probably
run out of charge
on the capacitor? Probably yes, but it doesn't limit you in any sense for a musical way. So okay. If you just use it normally for performing, you won't run into any problem here. Just if you play around, maybe if you force it, you might run into a situation where it needs to charge up again, but it never happened when I have performed with it. So this is really no practical problem.
So was it designed as a performance tool or for just kind of memorizing things?
I do a lot of live performances, so for me the performance aspect was most interesting because you get really big faders, you get many things mapped on one fader, so it's you save space. You can use it to have several presets and recall them. Or you can use them to map many functions in one fader in order to save space. For example, you have 8 envelopes and 4 faders, so you could have ADSR 8 times and switch over to which voice you want. What I'm showing here is something especially interesting. It's a sequencer. I've built, just as an example for the faders, I've built a 2-track performance sequencer with motor faders.
So how many faders could you chain together?
You can put 16 controllers on one master, so could be 64 faders, but I don't think it makes any sense. Usually would you have a couple of these modules for selecting presets or something, and maybe 2 of these. let's see what people do. I'm sure some people will buy four of these or eight or whatever.
So is it going to be something you need deep pockets for, or are these expensive? Because I imagine it's quite a lot of cost of components in there.
The motor faders are very expensive, so this will be probably about somewhere between 400 and 500 euros.
Right. So you're not going to buy 64 of them?
Probably someone will.
But not me, that's for sure.
Yeah,
I can afford that.
Maybe from time to time. So, but you are not limited to one function. So if you buy the faders and don't like a sequencer anymore, you can make tomorrow something different with it. So it's
a very really useful good. Building block.
Yeah, it's really a very very useful building block. And let's set up this. And a very good example why the faders make sense is this sequencer. These faders are programmed in a way that I just touch them and I've set up them as a mute button for two voices of the sequencer.
Okay, I'm impressed already.
Let's select one track of the sequencer. So, you see, I have 8 steps here. I also could make 16, but just for simplicity, we make 8 steps. So, and these are the pitches. So, so you have the pitch information. Let's make it a bit louder. Now you have several CVs for each note. So, if I select this button, for example, you get the release of the envelope. So you can make short and long notes, for example. Oh, I have a velocity. Let's try something. And here we have a glide. So we have several CVs, and you have the note. And the fun thing is, now if... Let's listen to this note, you know. You have to try it yourself, but you cannot because you hold your camera, don't you? But if I, there are now artificial notches here when I select pitch. So if I move it, I exactly can feel every single note here.
Ah, so you got haptic feedback.
Yeah.
Clever.
I think I shall hold the camera, and you need to try it out yourself because it's hard to explain, you know. But this is really okay.
I'm gonna film one-handed. Okay.
Yeah.
This is
to try it out because it's.
Oh wow.
You need to feel it.
Okay, that's a real step there.
And you have very precise control which notes you're playing. You see, you can exactly say I want one note up or down or two notes.
Oh, that's great. That's fantastic.
That's totally fun. But
I am impressed.
It's, yeah, it's totally useful because then you have total control of everything. I want next turn, I want one note up. You cannot do this with any other sequencer with normal faders.
It's just genius.
And when you press this button, it's a kind of menu. Then the faders have the meanings as labeled here. So every fader has a totally different function. Now this is an octave switch. Again with these artificial notches. Or maybe here I can shift the pattern in time. Together with the drums maybe.
So how do you set up those notches? How is that all informed? How do you
simply I want 10 notches. And then it makes 10 notches, and you can select the number 1 to 10.
So is this all part of the text file that's in the SD card?
Yeah. So you either can use a fader, let's say I just want this one fader to set something on it, or you use this whole sequencer function and simply say I want two fader blocks, and everything is set up for you. So you can make a deep dive onto a single fader, or you can use more complex building blocks. And it works out of the box more or less. So this is just an example. So now let's have a second track. You know, I've set up these as mute buttons. And now I have a second track, but I can change the note for that track. So and in live performance, it's very easy. One track two, change the notes, track one. Also, there's a snapshot feature, so I can make a snapshot. Let's make it like this. I like this melody. Make a snapshot of this sequence with this button here. And then I can change it, make something else. And with one button press, I return to the previous groove. So this is... Here we have just another example for using the Droid for selecting the scale, for example, the C major. This, but this is just an example. I mapped a couple of root notes here. So the actual functionality of the sequence is not finalized. I just wanted to show how you can use the faders and that it makes absolutely sense to build this sequence. So I had this idea already for years and I know that the fader works, it's working perfectly out. So I mean, there are a couple of multi-track performance sequences out there, like Stills and Hammer and so on, but you always have the problem that when you switch to another track, you don't see your sequence in front of you. The faders are also a display, you know, you can see your melody, and also you don't get haptic feedback when you have these small faders. Here you have big faders, and it's really for performing, you know.
It's very visual absolute. And tactile.
Yeah. That's also, there, you can make things like this. It's a pitch band wheel, basically, which automatically turns in the center. Also feels like one, so.
Wow, okay.
So that's the motor faders.
My mind is kind of somewhat blown.
Excuse me?
My mind is a little bit blown by that, that's pretty cool. So, availability, price, do we have that information?
I guess a small number of months for shipping. Let's say about 3 months until it's finished, and the price tag for the motor faders is probably about 100 euro per fader, a bit more maybe.
And the Droid?
This is already available. This is 388 euros. It's in production. It's shipped. If you order on the booth, you will get it when you are at home. The G8 is also available, and there's one last new module which is also very interesting. It's the X7. This expander gives you access to the SD card via USB, but the most interesting thing, it has a MIDI interface for in and out. So you have a classical MIDI to CV functionality, which everyone knows, it's nothing new, but it's very flexible, because inside the Droid you can make a completely flexible routing. You can make 8 voice polyphony if you want and everything. But even more interesting is that we also have a MIDI out, so I can generate CV in the Eurac, like this Quartz, for example, and then with the TRS MIDI out, I can use a hardware synth and integrate the polyphony into. Because more and more people like the user interface of the Eurac system to create LFOs, sequencers, stuff like that, and then actually play a hardware synth. So this is, I think, a new trend, that you don't use MIDI to sequence your modular, but use modular to sequence your MIDI stuff. So, and that's possible with this X7 expander. And yeah, this one what we see here is a trigger sequencer, also built out of Droid components. And the interesting thing is, it's on the one hand, it's a classic trigger sequencer where you get one button per step. But it's also algorithmic, so you have things like this, where you can say one more beat going on, one more activity. And as you turn it up, you get more and more beats. Or you can turn it to the left, and it gets more sparse and sparse. just one of several parameters. So you have, in addition to your sequence that you created, you have a kind of musical access to the energy of your music. You can make variation, you can increase the energy or make fewer energy. So it's an important building block for making live performances, actually. Where just with a few turns of the knobs you can evolve all your music. You can make a line from up to down, you know, the energy goes up and then goes down again, and you get variation. So, yeah.
That's a great ecosystem you built there.
Yeah, it's you basically can use the Droid in two different ways. You can use it as a Swiss Army knife with small utilities. I need a clock divider here that divides by 7. I need an envelope here. I need an LFO here. And stuff lots of these functions into one Droid. Or you can create a complex patch where the Droid is making all the music or any combination of it. So these are the usual two ways of using this system.
That's brilliant. Many thanks for that. It's fantastic.
So thanks for coming over.